There are many things to talk about in No Time to Die. I made a video of me briefly analyzing the film in my native language, the Thai language, but apparently no one in Thailand cares about my opinion. However, I still want to talk about the subjects that I haven't seen people bring up yet, so I guess I could have a chance to discuss with another human being if I make a video in English. And the reason why I want to talk about No Time to Die so much is that the movie is so flawed, deeply flawed, but I love that movie, so I just want to explain where it fails and where it succeeds. A disclaimer, I'm not a film student. I study literature as a minor, and that's it. Another thing is, I'm not the biggest Bond fan. I've watched all of them, but remember only movies from Brosnan era and Craig era, because I'm not so fond of own films. I never read the books. They are hard to find in Thailand. So people who actually read them explained them to me. Right after watching No Time to Die, I left the theater with mixed feeling, since the good and the bad exist simultaneously in it. It's most emotional Bond film ever. It makes me cry so bad, and it brings the franchise closer to my heart. On the other hand, the storytelling is so sloppy. Many setups but no payoff, unsatisfied character arc, strange Bond characterization, and so on. I think the movie is better than Spectre. There are things to love more than Quantum of Solace, but many elements in it don't jive together in the same way that they do in Quantum, which is better as a whole film. But first, we need to have a closer look at the bones of the movie. Starting from the beginning, I've watched the films just once, so I have to dig everything out of my memory. Spoiler alert, No Time to Die is about letting people in. Bond has never learned how to do that, and he must learn it in the last film. Well, at least that's what the movie is trying to tell us in the first and the second act. So James ends his relationship with Madeline in the opening scenes, showing how broken he is. He leaves her to be in Jamaica, and Felix, the CIA guy played by Jeffrey Wright, asks him for help. Bond is reluctant until he meets a new 007 played by Lashana Lynch. Her name is Nomi, and he realized that MI6 is hiding something from him, so he starts the new mission to learn who can he trust. This is the end of Act 1, when he decided to go to Cuba. We got backstory, we got inciting incident, we got the central conflict. Why is it important? Because I want to point that Bond trusting issue is the central conflict. Bond feels like he cannot trust anyone, and he wants to be alone, be isolated, but fundamentally he just doesn't want to get hurt emotionally after West Berlin. However, we know that he needs to stop being hypervigilant and let people into his life in order to grow, because want versus needs is how we get the satisfying character arc. Characters want something, but in order to grow, they need to do something more important. Bond wants to be alone so that he could feel secure again, but he needs to learn how to let people in and don't be so paranoid about having women in his life. Now, he sets out on the journey to end this mess once and for all. This is becoming more interesting in the second act. Felix is killed and James like, oh no, my bro, we need more time together. Now he begins to realize the importance of intimacy. It makes time worth living, and he goes back to England to reconnect with Madeline. He faces Bofell and he tells him, "You have trusting issues. Your girlfriend didn't betray you. Now fly away and be with her." And then he knows now he never wants to be alone. He wanted to be with Vesper. And now he learns to trust Madeline, exposing his weakness to make time worthy to live again. So he goes to Norway to be with her because he is ready to let her in now. That's not even the end of Act 2. Why is that? Because we have the new central conflict. Surprise, James Bond has a daughter, but Madeline doesn't accept him as her father because he's a broken man who hasn't contributed anything to his family. Apparently, she doesn't hate him, but she doesn't want her daughter to carry his legacy yet. It builds the new character arc, new one versus need, because he already let Madeline back in his life before the end of Act 2. So the first conflict is solved. If Bond doesn't want to feel betrayed, he needs to open himself only to people who are worth living for, like Felix, Madeline. Now the central conflict is, can he protect his family? He wants to be with them, but he needs to contribute something to them to gain their trust to be family again. Let's stop here for a moment. This is why the movie is interesting. In many movies, the main central conflict will be solved at the end. Let's take a look at Skyfall, one of the best Bond films. It's very satisfying because Bond has one whole arc that connects to the theme. It's about old style espionage versus cyber terrorists. Is the new age of crime and Bond is getting old. The central conflict is whether Bond is too old for being 007. He wants to perceive as cool as in the past, but he needs to accept that he is old and he has to adapt, not by learning to be a tech-savvy spy, but by being creative in old-fashioned tactics. He succeeds in the end. He used a knife to kill a cyber terrorist. It has been set up and paid off. You see, this is why No Time to Die isn't that satisfying. We don't fully invest in one conflict. We invest in two conflicts. And that's not even the bad thing. It means that the filmmakers take risks and want to be innovative, but the structure is kind of easy to get lost while writing a screenplay. I'm going to talk about a bad thing that stems from this structure. Setups in Act 1 and Act 2 are dismissed in Act 3. In Act 1 and Act 2, you can sense that everyone is sus. M is sus, Nomi is sus, Felix is a little bit sus, Logan Ash is sus, Paloma is kind of sus. Is the theme of trust, and then we learn who is good and who is bad real quick. M telling the truth to Bond. Nomi, she doesn't have any hidden agenda. It makes me feel incomplete. This is also affects the main villain. Safin is not a real villain in Act 1 and Act 2. He has nothing to do with Bond until Act 3. He is presented as just another baddie. Bond tells M that he's just another terrorist. They don't even care about his motivation when they talk about him on the bridge. I like Silva from Skyfall. His motivation is not associated with the trusting issue that Bond has. So Safin is not a good villain for the whole movie, but good for the theme in Act 3. Talking about the third act, I think it's weaker than how it should be. There is a scene when Bond tells M to bomb Safin's island, but M is hesitant because he has to tell the world that MI6 created a nanobot virus, dangerous weapon that can kill millions. Now let's picture if the conflicts in the third act was still about opening yourself, I think he might have to choose to tell the truth about Nanobot. In order to help Bond, he would have served as a subplot character, reiterating the conflict in the third act. But no, it doesn't happen, because again, that conflict ends before Act 3, and the final showdown is a little bit disengaging. Another issue that I have is Bond characterization. Bond just meets his daughter and she is taken away right after. Now the filmmaker have to convince us that Bond deeply cares about his child. So when it comes to his daughter affair, he talks a lot, and that's not how Bond is portrayed by Daniel Craig. You can sense that there is something off with his character. Therefore, No Time to Die leaves weird tastes in my mouth, but how can I still love it? Besides decent action sequences, Hans Zimmer's music, beautiful location, good callback from previous films, humor, Ana de Armas, and my new favorite evil henchman, the emotional impact is probably what gets me the most. If you approach the conversation between Safin and Bond in his evil secret base with a thematic read, you will see that they are talking about their legacy, what they will leave after they're gone. He wants to leave Nanobot for the next generation, but Bond doesn't. He wants to protect them. He wants to leave a better world for them, especially for his daughter, Mathilde. The virus can transmit from people in the same family. It ties the theme of legacy with the plot. Then Safin tests him. He spread the virus to Bond, and it will kill his family if he returns to them. In the final moment, he makes it clear that he would do anything for his daughter. He wouldn't pass the sickness to her. He sacrificed his life for the ones he loves the most. I cried so bad at the end, because now Bond is less super spy character but more just a character that I care. And the message of legacy that we leave for the next generation hit me so hard. Kudos to Daniel Craig and Lea Seydoux, they sell it. I didn't really buy them as a couple in Spectre, but in this film, we watched them trying to do their best to be good parents, despite never witnessing it themselves. It's ironic, because the thing that makes me love watching Bond films is his carefree personality, and now I want him to be a father, to be a better person for his family. It's quite a revolution for the franchise. James Bond finally have a very emotional closure, and it opens many doors for the future Bond films, because the creator need to find any way to portray Bond after he's now family oriented man. He respect women. He's woke now. Many criticism online talk about Bond in No Time to Die being woke, and that's the main reason why many of them hate the movie, not the structure issue that was mentioned earlier. To call No Time to Die woke, well, they're not wrong. According to the article of Aja Romano from Vox, History of Wokeness. Woke was formerly used by Black Lives Matters activists. Now woke is the term widely used by right-leaning community to describe the character of leftist ideology. Does No Time to Die have a leftist political ideology? I think so. Bond girls in this film, Nomi and Paloma, no longer thirst for James Bond. One example of the feminist aspect in No Time to Die is how Paloma is framed. She dresses seductively, just like Severine from Skyfall. They are also introduced from behind, building expectation that they would fit the same archetype, but Paloma is memorable because she breaks the archetype of seductive women in trouble. She's quirky, she's bubbly, and she doesn't want to have sex with Bond. Even her action might lead men to think so. Her existence reminds us not to take women like her for granted. Madeline has an agency to be in the story, to protect her daughter. Her role feels almost as important again as Bond despite having fewer screen times. And the most leftist element in the film for me is Bond trying to stop Nanobot, as if he was trying to stop the sickness that spreads from generation to generation, which is, from the meta-textual read, the conservative norms from previous Bond film that still remains in the modern era. But why it makes a left-leaning statement? Maybe we have to look at why Bond was made in the first place. I'm not going to talk much about Ian Fleming's books, but here is the thing that you need to know. Fleming inserted himself in James Bond. Fleming, where Bond began documentary broadcasted in 2008, indicates that the material that Fleming used to craft the book were his own experience. How he approached Bond was almost like Stephanie Meyer's approach to Twilight. You see, they both created protagonists that are not supposed to be role models. They are made to be vehicles for escapism. In the video titled Why Bond Gets Constantly Invented from the YouTube channel, Steve Ramsden, he explained that Bond is exclusive. He is an upper-class Englishman who doesn't have to care about women's feelings that much. He is the insider and you are the outsider. He makes you crave to be in his circle, but not really to be him. But in the movie version, the filmmakers make sure that if you are a man, you want to be him, and if you are a woman, you want to be with him. The reason is that they try to make him more appealing to global audiences. Now we got Sean Connery as charming Scottish man with working class background, and bam, most iconic character in the cinema. However, at the core, he's just the same sexist misogynist, and there's possibility that male audiences adopted some of his attitude toward women by osmosis. But after 5 films of Eon production, Bond series established some conventions that later became embedded and need to be reinvented. It is something inevitable, the essay of John Cavity explain why Chinatown is so great, because it plays with the hard-boiled detective genre. And twisted, it exposed the moral ambiguity of the world, which previous film in the same genre superficially touched. Personally, I think that's how people react to the media naturally. When there's something missing in them, we demand more, just like people in The Matrix question their reality. The name of that way of thinking is postmodernism, when you question the truth of the universe in the modern era. Bond films therefore needed to be reinvented, and Bond himself had to be real. No Time to Die is not the first time Bond get air quote woke. He already did in On Her Majesty's Secret Service, because like what happened to hard boy detective movies, they needed to grow. On Her Majesty's Secret Service, the first Bond film that features a serious relationship of James Bond with his girlfriend. He respects her, he marries her, and if you pay attention, there is reference to Secret Service in No Time to Die. For example, the statue with Trident in the opening sequence and the music. Hans Zimmer deliberately put Secret Service theme by John Barry in a track called Good to Have You Back. In some way, No Time to Die is the deconstruction of On Her Majesty's Secret Service. In the Secret Service, Olenna Tyrell's George Lazenby's girlfriend dies so that the franchise can go back to its root when Sean Connery was still James Bond. But in No Time to Die, Bond is dead so that the franchise has an opportunity to go to the territory that it has never been before. And in the 90s, we got Judi Dench in GoldenEye. She called Bond a sexist misogynist dinosaur. You see, these updates were not solely initiated by the internet leftists, but the public's demand to react to societal rules. Now, enter Craig era, we have 2 films, Casino Royale and Quantum Solace, which explore the iconic sexist misogynist in a meaningful way. The first Craig Bond film doesn't shy away from the fact that he's problematic, but explores why he's like that. It's like the origin story of an anti-hero. With good writing, we can engage with the anti-heroes as we understand what drives them. This approach continues in Quantum, and I thought this was how we were going to experience watching Bond films in Craig era. Learning why he doesn't have a healthy relationship with women, but everything changes in Skyfall and Spectre because Sam Mendes tackles these with more conservative perspective. The message in the film is the old and traditional ways are still relevant in modern era, and we should take Bond back to his root. Characters like Severine and Lucius are typical Bond girls who are framed with the male gaze. The moment Bond emotionally supports women, like when he comforts Vesper in the shower or when he talks to Camille in the cave, are not presented in Mendes' versions. However, it couldn't continue in that direction because we face too many social injustices. After Me Too and Black Lives Matter movements, we couldn't go back to 1960. That's why I think No Time to Die is the most important film in Craig era. It makes a strong political statement about the franchise. Unlike other woke movies, such as Disney live action remake that get woke to attract the demographic of liberal women, No Time to Die has a reason to exist. It sends a message to its fans, especially male fans, that Bond are prepared to exist in the modern era when social issues must be acknowledged. The franchise can grow and have higher morality, just like James Bond himself. He sacrificed himself to leave the legacy of goodness for his daughter. That's why Madeleine accepts him as Mathilde's father, because despite being flawed and broken in the past, he can be a better man. It's beautiful. Some people raise question whether Bond should be a woman in the future, and I don't think so. Bond movies are like records or time capsules of idealistic men. How men project themselves and who they are inspired to be at a specific period of time. He can be a sexist, misogynist dinosaur, or a loving father who will do anything for his family. And I want to know what that man could be in the future. It's interesting hearing Cary Fukunaga told Collider interviews that the title was picked after the production had begun for a while, because then they knew what they wanted to say to the audience. After the franchise makes such a statement, many opportunities are open in the future, and there is no time to die for the
James Bond.